For you are our heart's one desire. I'm thirsty for you. I'm thirsty for you. You are our heart's one desire. Only you can satisfy. Only you can satisfy. For you are our heart's one desire. Only you can satisfy. Only you can satisfy. Sing, you are one desire. I'm thirsty for you.
Thirsty for you.
I'm thirsty for you.
Thirsty for you.
Sing, you are,
you are our
one desire. Only you can satisfy.
Only you can satisfy.
Only you can satisfy.
Only you can satisfy.
Let's sing it again.
Sing, you are,
you are our
one desire.
Desire.
I'm thirsty for you.
Thirsty for you.
This is my only prayer. Sing,
you are
one desire.
Only you can satisfy.
Only you can satisfy. Come on, let's sing it together. Sing,
you are
one desire.
I'm thirsty for you.
I'm thirsty for you.
You are
our one desire. Only you can satisfy.
Only you can satisfy.
Come on, one last time. Sing,
you are
one desire.
I'm thirsty for you.
I'm thirsty for you. Sing,
you
are. Presence to dwell.
Move whatever.
Whatever took your place.
Seem
to dwell here.
It's
our one heart's desire to have your presence, Jesus. Move whatever's in your way.
Whatever took your place.
Sing, you are. One desire,
I'm thirsty for you.
I'm thirsty for you. Sing,
you are
our one desire.
Only you can satisfy.
Only you can satisfy. Come on, let's sing that together.
Sing,
you are one desire.
I'm
thirsty for you.
This is my only prayer.
Sing, you are
our
one desire.
Only you can satisfy.
Only you can satisfy. Come on, let me hear you sing it. Sing,
you are
one desire. We're thirsty for you.
Yes, Lord.
We're thirsty for you.
Yes, Lord, you sound good.
Sing, you are one desire. Only you can satisfy. Only you can satisfy.
Come on, let's sing that one time.
Sing, you are. I want desire.
I'm thirsty for you.
I'm thirsty for you.
Yes, Lord.
Sing, you are.
You are have one desire. Only you can satisfy. Only you can satisfy.
So dwell here. Father, we want your presence to dwell here. Move whatever's in your way.
Whatever took your place.
Say, dwell here. We want you to have your way. Is waiting on you. We bless your name, Jesus. We want you to have your way. Hallelujah, we bless your name. We glorify you. We worship and adore you. Sing, dwell here. Dwell here.
So dwell here, dwell here. Move whatever's in your way, whatever took your place. So dwell here, Lord, dwell here. Move whatever's in your way, whatever took your place. Move whatever's in your way, whatever took your place. Move whatever's in your way, whatever took your place. Move whatever, whatever took your place. Move whatever,
whatever's in your way,
whatever took your place.
Come on and open up your mouths and begin to worship him. Come on, open up your mouths and begin to worship him.
We honor your name, Jesus. We long for your presence. 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 We long for your presence.
Come on, his presence is here. Allow him to invade your space. Allow him to invade. Come
Come on, allow him to invade your space.
All my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, for I will sing of the goodness of God.
Come on, I hear you. Let's sing it. Sing all my life.
All my life,
you have been so, so good.
With every breath I'm able,
every breath
that I am able,
I will sing
of the goodness.
Oh, Shaman, did it, Osiah. Come on, let's sing it. Sing all my life. Are you thankful? Yes, God. And
all my life, you have been so, so good.
Every breath I'm able,
every breath that I am able,
I will sing of the goodness of God.
Come on, let's sing that out with the assistance of music.
Sing all my life.
With every breath I'm able,
every breath that I am able,
I will sing of the goodness of God.
Come on, let's sing that one more time.
And
all my life you have been faithful.
Has he been faithful? Has he been good to you? And all my life you've been so good.
With every breath I'm able,
hey, you're not on my shire,
who I will sing of the goodness. Cause your goodness is running out, it's running after me.
Come on, let's sing it together.
Your goodness is running out, it's running after me. With my life laid out. Give you everything, cause
your goodness is running out.
It's running
out.
Come on, let's sing it. Sing
your goodness is running out.
It's running out.
Hey
God, your goodness is running out of me. Yes, Lord.
It's running out to me.
With my life laid out.
You everything, cause your goodness is running out. It's running out. Come on, let's sing it. Sing
your goodness.
It's running out.
Your goodness is running out.
It's running out.
My life laid out.
I give you everything.
Sing your goodness.
Your goodness is running out.
It's running out.
It's running out to me.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now it's possible to be in a room full of people, but you gotta have your personal testimony, your personal declaration. Early they said, dwell here. The only way they can dwell here in restoration, you gotta have it in your own personal heart. So for the next few moments, can we worship and lay aside everything? Forget about what happened this year. Forget about what happened at the dinner table. Forget about what happened this week. But focus on our King. Lay it aside. Focus on the goodness of God. Because I promise you, if he dwell here, you will have the peace. You will have the joy. You will have the love. But you have to remember, you gotta lay it aside. You gotta lay it aside. Everything that's trying to bring you down. put it to the side. His goodness is running after us. Hallelujah. We thank you, Jesus. 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 So I want you to just think about those things. The things you didn't tell people about. The things that's weighing heavy on your heart. You know, during this time, grief tries to rise up during the holidays. And you got to lay that aside. I'm not telling you not to cry, but I'm telling you, don't let it stop you. Don't let it stop you. Because his goodness is running after you. His promises are yay and amen. But you got to know what those promises are. Hallelujah.
When they were singing, I was thinking about where I was this time last year. And that was the lowest period, I think, since being pregnant. That was the lowest period of my life. I was just recently married, moved here, but no job. And I'm always the one to have a job. But God just reminded me that I'm not where I was this time last year. This past week, I just got promoted. Never once did my faith alter. It was a little shaky, but God reminded me that his faithfulness will never run out. If I'm faithful to him, my praise never altered. Because I knew in the midst of my praise, God will continue to bless me. I will continue to have a roof over my head. My bills will be paid on time. Never once did I forget to tithe. If anything, my tithe was greater during that season. And now I'm standing here with a child, a husband, and a promoted job. So if anything, today I'm thankful. I'm thankful, even in the midst of the storm, I'm still thankful because God allowed my testimony to be even greater. So even in today, dwell in the season that you're in because it's not a forever place. But in this moment, God is trying to position you into where he wants you to, where he wants to take you next. So even in the midst of the service, continue to dwell in the presence. Continue to think about the goodness of God. Continue to think of all the many things, even in the midst of it, whatever season that you're going through, this season will not last. So we just thank God. We're thankful. We're so thankful today. I don't see no one that's lacking anything. We all have clothes on our body. So we just thank you. And so with that being said, we thank you for joining us at the greatest church on this side of heaven, which is Restoration Church. That's right. We thank God that we can come into a house of worship.
Well, clap your hands, all ye people. Shout to God with a voice of triumph. I said, clap your hands, all ye people, and shout. I see you clapping, but you're not shouting. Clap your hands, all ye people, and shout to God with a voice of triumph. I know you feel a little heavy. You ate too much, but the Lord is still good. We didn't have to bury nobody this week, so the Lord is still good. Some of us was on the road this week. No accidents and no incidents. The Lord is still good. I'm thankful today. Glory be to God. Your children are healthy. You're in this place. You walked in here by yourself, so glory be to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hold on, musicians. Let's bring it down. When my wife was testifying, she told her side of the story. So let me tell my side of the story. Because as a husband, we're providers. And at that time, I knew I didn't have all of it to cover all three of us. But I tell you, we still got a house to live in. My baby's still eating good formula, and we still eating good. You can tell I'm gaining weight. So when you feel down, know that the Lord is a provider. In spite of what it looks like, Because faith, hallelujah, use your faith. That's your word for this week and for the rest of the month. Use your faith. What's the point of having it if you're not going to use it? Glory be to God. I said use your faith. Hallelujah. So while we're in this good vein, I ask that everyone please stand as we greet our neighbors in this vein. I know you want to dance. If you want to dance, we could have danced, but we know no warm-ups. There's no warm-ups. So if we're going to do it, we're going to do it. So either we're going to go hug or we're going to dance right now. We can make the decision, but the Lord is good. So how about this? We're going to take a good 30 seconds because we still in the spirit of Thanksgiving. Because, you know, let me hold on, musicians. You know, I know you seem like it's cliche to come in here and dance every week, but I don't know if you watched the Thanksgiving service. There was a time where I couldn't dance. I was given doctor orders to do whatever. He said, what are you doing at that church? You need to just sit on down. Well, I come to tell you, I haven't had a seizure since then. And my heart is fully recovered. And I ain't gotta be in no hospital. So I'm gonna praise him while I can. Praise him while you can. See, everybody can't do this. Some people had to bury this week. So you ought to praise him while you can. Praise him, children. Hallelujah! To God be the glory. Hallelujah! I know you feel heavy. That trial, that situation is weighing on you. But I promise you, if you jump in his praise, he'll shake it off of you. Hallelujah! With a spirit of heaviness, put on a garment of praise. Everywhere I go, all is well. I said, all is well. Your family, your finances, Restoration Church, all is well. Hallelujah. Praise them, children. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The babies are praising. I don't want to cut the babies off. Let the babies praise them. Because they doing it for their generation. I wish my generation would catch up to what the babies see. Hallelujah. Catch up. Let the children praise them. Let the children praise them. You think they just dancing, but God could be speaking to them right now. They praying for their mama. They praying for their daddy. Hallelujah. Let the peer praise them. Hallelujah. Oh. That's right, Sister Kayla. She just caught it. All is well.
Now, some of y'all don't know, but a young lady has been in the hospital for the last week. Our elders and ministers went to go see her. I didn't know she was coming to church today. But the only time I need you to look back is when you need to see the blessing of the Lord. Everybody look in the back of the room. Katie just walked in. You want to start dancing right now. Hello! Someone to dance for Katie. I need someone to dance for Katie. I need someone to dance for Katie. I need someone to dance for Katie. Oh!
him do it. Miracles, signs, and wonders. This is restoration. You can come here and get restored. Don't look at what the doctor said. Get to the house of the Lord, and you'll get restored. If you can just make it here, hallelujah. We're living up to the name. If you have a question of the title of this church, just look at Katie. If you ever wondering why we call restoration, look at your neighbor. I seen him do it. I seen it with my own eyes. I said I seen it with my own eyes. Yeah, change the report. Stop getting weary. You're doing good, well doing. Don't get weary, well doing. I promise you, the report's going to change. Restoration Church, the report's going to change. Restoration Church, the report is going to change. Look at your credit, it's going to change. Look at your health, it's going to change. Just be faithful unto God. And he'll be faithful to you. Praise him, family. You're going to put your family. Hallelujah. The Bartons will have a testimony that he did it again. I said the Bartons will have a testimony that God did it again. What they saw, they see no more. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I keep hearing it. Reports are changing. I'm trying to shake it off, but reports are changing. The report that I heard is changing. Reports are changing. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Just lift your hands in this atmosphere. I know it was loud. Y'all might not have heard me, but I keep hearing it. Reports are changing. Reports are changing. I don't know what that means for somebody, but I hear reports are changing. You looking at that doctor notice, you looking at those bills on the table, but I promise you, I keep hearing reports are changing. So if you could just tap in this atmosphere, you ain't gotta dance, but just receive it. Hallelujah. Reports are changing, hallelujah. Because he dwells here. Reports are changing. Because we moved all that other stuff out the way. Hallelujah. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Jesus. Because the report has changed. I was saying it's changing, but for somebody, the report has changed already. Hallelujah. You ain't got to wait for it because it has changed. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. See, Kayla got the revelation. So when she come in here next week testifying about it, I don't need nobody to get jealous because the report has changed and she caught it. Hallelujah! Hallelujah. Amen. Yes, Lord. Just lift those hands up. Yes, Lord. Thank you, musicians. Hallelujah. Restoration Church, things are changing for us. So stop looking at things that don't matter. Stop worrying about who's here, who's not here. Because if you're here, you can change that narrative. If you get here, they're teaching everything that you need to succeed out those doors. So if you just make it an effort to get here, I know I'm preaching to the choir, but you're gonna think about this later on because your body's gonna ache next week and try to keep you home. That rain outside gonna make you, it's getting cold and you're gonna wanna stay home. But if you can do anything, just make it to the house of the Lord because we live up to the name of restoration. And if you can get here, you will be restored. You will be renewed and you will be revived. Hallelujah, we just thank you. Can we just give God a wave offering for being good? In spite of what we've done, we couldn't be perfect enough, we couldn't be good enough, and he still allowed us to get here. We're still able to hear, still able to see, still able to move and have our beings. But it's because of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed. God, we thank you. Not just because Thanksgiving was this week, but God, we have a posture of Thanksgiving because you are with us. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Amen. Well, if you are visiting here for the very first time, we hope that you receive a card at the door. We ask that you put that card in the offering plate or hand it to one of our nice greeters at the door. Fill that out. I promise you, we're not going to overwhelm you with spam. We just want to get some good information to you. We have everything here at Restoration. We have things for your children, things for the men, things for the women. And we just want you to have that information, especially on days like this, because I don't even know if we're streaming. See, that's why it's important to be in the house of the Lord, because you can't receive the good news that God has in store for you. So at this time, I ask that everyone please rest on your feet and go greet and hug at least 5 people and tell them one reason why you're thankful.
Happy Sunday. My name is Celia Graham, and I want to thank all of our first-time visitors for joining in for an amazing worship experience. If you would like to stay connected, feel free to scan the QR code that is on your screen now. Grab your calendars because here are your weekly announcements. Hey, Life Groups, don't forget that all of our donations are due by December 3rd, as our evangelism team will be going to the Harriet Tubman Women's Shelter in Washington, D.C. on December 9th. If you have any questions, feel free to reach out to our evangelism director, Daisha Kelly. Let's be a blessing. I'm not sure about you, but I love our leading lady. On December 10th at 1:30 p.m., right here at Restoration Church, we will be taking the opportunity to love on our very own leading lady, Melissa Johnson. And joining us will be Dr. Shekinah Rawlings. So grab your party hats because it's time to celebrate. We hope to see you there.
Esteemed honor of us introducing our pastor. He's a great man of God. When we first joined, he was very welcoming, him and Lady Mail. Let's thank God for Lady Mail, the fragrance of this house. And so we just thank God for our pastor. So if everyone could just please stand as we receive our pastor, Overseer Rennell Johnson.
You may be seated. God bless you, everybody. We are thankful for you, you and you. Anybody glad to be in the house of the Lord today? Now, I know y'all ate a lot, but I still need Restoration Church to be present today. So everybody who loves Jesus, holler at the top of your voice and say, I love him. Amen. Amen. Tell somebody in your room, say, I do love him. I really do. I love him even on a holiday weekend. I love him. After all the sacrifices he made for me, he is a good God. Jeremiah said, this I recall to my mind. Therefore, I have hope. It is of the Lord's mercies that we have not been consumed. His compassion, it fails not. His mercies are new every morning. I need you to do like this. Look at somebody and say, great is his faithfulness. I don't see you doing that. I need you to look at somebody and say, great is his faithfulness. That don't mean nothing to you unless you've been unfaithful. But I need every unfaithful person to look at somebody and say, he been faithful to an unfaithful me. All right, God bless you. All right, I can see what kind of service we're going to have today. Amen. Amen. God's going to get the glory. Amen. I will praise him by myself. Amen. If I need to, I am. Thank you very much. At least I got the praise team. Amen. You're going to fight for me, and I'm grateful to each and every one of you being here today. I have the distinct honor, first of all, of pastoring the greatest church in the world. That's number one. Amen. I want to welcome you to Restoration Church, the place where you'll be restored, renewed, and revived. I have the honor of, we have some guests with us today, and I'm so excited that they are here, and I want them to stand. We have the Johnson Middle School Lady Panthers basketball team. Stand up, girls. Stand up, stand up, stand up. Restoration Church, give them a great God bless you. Oh, come on, clap them louder than that. Thank you for coming to church today. Amen. Minister Eileen, I love you so much and thank God for you. And she reached out to me. She said, I told them all about RC and I want them to come. I said, get them to come. We'll make a big fuss over them. I mean, and before service is over, I'm going to pray over them because I believe in God that they're going to have a winning season this year. Amen. You know, God can work in sports too if you let him. Amen. Amen. And he can remove his hand from teams too. Ask the Washington Commanders. They know all about that. I'm just saying, Thanksgiving was rough for the Commanders. Amen. He can take his hand off a team too. Amen. Just saying. Amen. But to my Eagles fans, Kayla's in here somewhere. I know I got some Eagles fans in here somewhere. There you go. 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 Amen. Amen. And so I'm so glad to have you here, Johnson Middle School Lady Panthers basketball team. Is that, where is the school located? Southeast DC. Amen. We are grateful to you. After church today, we're going to take a pic. We're going to take a picture. We will do that too, but I want to pray over you that God will bless you. To all the parents who came, God bless you. Thank you for bringing them and welcome to Restoration Church. I pray you've been blessed so far. Amen. These children did not come by themselves, right? Somebody had to bring them. So thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule on a holiday weekend to come and hang out with us today. And great minds think alike, clearly. Amen. Is yellow y'all's color? Look at that. That's prophetic. Look. Ain't nobody told me to wear yellow today. That was God. Amen. I hear from God. I do. Amen. I want to say happy birthday to Jeremiah Islar. It's his birthday today. Give him a good break. God bless you. Happy birthday to you, man of God. Amen. And also, I want to, what day is it? 26th on Tuesday is Jairus' birthday. Happy birthday to you, Jairus. Amen. Kurt Price's birthday this week. Happy birthday to you. Sharice Cunningham, happy birthday to you this week. Ava Lee, is her birthday this week. Shantae, I know I saw you. Where you at, Shantae? She's serving today. Happy birthday to Shantae. Amen. This birthday is also Elijah's birthday this week. Elijah Wright, Chelsea and Deacon Ian's youngest. And it's Zaria's birthday this week too. Happy birthday to everybody in the house. We thank God. I see you, Jordy. Amen. Amen. Hollering for her child. Amen. We have a very special month coming up because we will also celebrate, amen, the birthday of our leading lady. And I'm excited about that. Amen. December 10th. Everyone say December 10th. Her birthday is December 12th. Her birthday is December 12th, but on December 10th, that Sunday, we take one Sunday out a year to celebrate our leading lady, and I think that that is honorable to do that. I said to Aberdeen this morning, and I'll say it here, Restoration Church just isn't what it is if I'm doing it by myself. Amen. Somebody had to stand by my side and make it happen. And so as you celebrate Founders Day in June, let us come together and celebrate the leading lady of this house on December 10th at 1:30. Amen. One of her best friends is coming, and she's not just coming because she's a best friend. She's coming because she's anointed. But Dr. Shekinah Rawlings will be coming to preach for us. Amen. I'm excited about what the Lord is going to do. Anybody ready for Leading Lady Day? Good. Good. However you want to serve today in your giving, Minister Latika's to my right, to your left, if you want to give electronically, all the other ways to give are on the screen. Amen. I love what Pastor Juan, didn't he do an incredible job last week? I love what he said, and it's been sitting in my heart all week. You want to see your church do well, you do it by giving. That's the reality. I tell you, y'all may not have taken it as a rebuke. I took it as a rebuke. Because we must have this understanding that we must be praisers and we must be dancers and worshipers, but we must also be givers. As quick as we are to dance, we ought to be just as quick to give. And we are not going to see changes in our church until we prioritize giving like we do praising God. Come on, somebody. Amen. As you breathe, you ought to be a giver. I just need about 15 people to shout and say, I want to be a generous giver. Yes. Listen, God has no problem. I tell God all the time, you give me $1 million, I will tithe. I got no problem. Amen. $20 million, $1 billion. You're not going to have to chase me for some money. And how do I know that's true? Because with the little I have, God don't have to chase me for my money. If you're faithful over God will make you ruler over. We don't have the many because we can't be trusted with the few. But I need someone to understand as we get ready to go into Christmas season that we must be faithful in our giving and must be faithful in our tithing. Amen? Amen. So get the best seed you can today. Get the best seed you can. Restoration Church, you want to see your church do great things. It happens through your giving. Amen. And so when you're ready to give, would you please stand to your feet all over the room? Let's declare it together. Some of you have already given. We thank God for those of you who give on payday. Amen. Amen. That was loud. Amen. All the people who give on payday, make some noise. Praise God. Wow. That made me a little emotional. Amen. I love it. Y'all just don't know how much you encourage your pastor. That's a blessing. Amen. Let's declare it together. I am a tither. And I'm not ashamed to say it. I believe in giving to God first. Today, my giving is on assignment. My giving rebuke the devourer for my sake. Satan, the Lord rebuke you. Somebody say that again. That means take your hand off of my money. Everyone shout and say, take your hand off my money. And angels, the Lord release you. This is our declaration. I shall walk in prosperity. I shall live in overflow. Favor is chasing me down. Bills will be paid on time, and I'll still have more than. Sometimes bills get paid, but after we pay our bills, we don't have much left. But I'm declaring over everybody in this house, by the time you finish paying your bills, you'll still have something to live on. Tell somebody, it will not be paycheck to paycheck. As you walk into 2024, you are going to walk into a prosperous season. And I need someone to catch the wind of the Holy Ghost and say, for me and my family, I will still have more than enough. Increase shall be my portion. It shall be big. No more foreclosures. No more evictions. No more repossessions. No more. Tell somebody you're going to keep it. Because I'm going to experience abundance. I will walk in the blessing of the Lord. I will buy it. I will own it. I will acquire it. Let me prophesy over you. Not only are you going to buy it, but God's going to put the right people in your life to buy it at discount. I feel a prophetic wind in this house today. I don't know what's going on, but I feel the Holy Ghost speaking to me. I need you to send it down your row and say, discount. In 2024, you will not pay full price for anything. God's going to give you a discount. Somebody shout it. Say, discount, discount. I will buy it, I will own it, I will acquire it, I will secure it. It's going to happen, and I'm going to live to see it. Hold up. What God's getting ready to do for me is not just for me, it's for generations coming after me. This is the difference between being rich and being wealthy. I don't want just money for me. I want generational wealth. Come on, somebody. I'm not going, thank God if a scholarship comes to my children, but if it don't, I will have the money for it. I need you to shout at somebody and say, I'm going to live to see it. I don't want to be a people that keeps preaching it and praying over it and believing it and then we don't see it. At some point, we got to stop saying, God's gonna, God's gonna, God's gonna. We got to say, God did. Can you just prophesy to somebody and say, in 2024, God did. No, I need you to find somebody who got the Holy Ghost. Look at somebody else and say, in 2024, your testimony will be, God did. Somebody shout, I'm going to live to see it. But first, what do? I give to God. I agree with God. In Jesus' name, everyone say amen. If you believe that for your finances, praise God for your finances right now. Come on, church, praise Him for your money. Praise Him for increase. Praise Him for favor. Praise Him for what He's getting ready to do. Father, we thank You now. And it shall be so. God did. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Would you stand to your feet and follow the rest of the ushers and give cheerfully today. God bless you in Jesus' name. Let us give unto the Lord. And he built an altar there and called the place El Bethel, because there God appeared to him when he fled from the face of his brother. I don't have a deep subject today. Just I want to talk about finding God again. Amen. Just tell somebody, say, I'm trying to find God again. Maybe seated. Tell one more person as you're being seated, I'm trying to find God again. When you talk about finding God, to find Him is this desire to want to know Him. Paul says, I want to know Him. But it's important for us to recognize how Paul wants to know Him. Because when you talk about knowing someone, you cannot know someone in a way that works for you. If you're going to know somebody, you're going to have to find them on their level. So Paul, when he says, I want to know Him, he says, I want to know Him in the power of His resurrection. But I can only go to the power of His resurrection if I go through the fellowship of His suffering, being made conformable to His death. So there's this idea that I cannot really know God. Listen to me. This ain't going to make people say amen, but I'm going to say it anyway. You cannot know God without suffering. I told you I'm going to get many amens there, because the God we want to know is the God we think He is. But the Bible says in Exodus 20 that we are not to build of ourselves any graven image. In other words, we should not worship the God we think He is. We should worship the God that He is. And you cannot know God without being committed to a life of suffering. Pastor, I'm finding it difficult to accept that, because He's God. If He's God, why do I have to suffer? Because Jesus had to suffer. And He learned obedience. I wish I had somebody to talk to me. Through the things that He suffered. And so if I truly want to know Him, it is this idea that I've got to do what Jesus said. He said, whoever wants to come after me, I have three principles for them. Number one, they have to deny themselves. I need you to touch somebody and say, deny yourself. Because if I'm going to be who God's called me to be, I can't be committed to my own agenda. I want to be who God wants me to be at the same time. Before I even get to Him, I've got to first deny me. Otherwise, I will bring to Him somebody who I want to be and not somebody that who He is making me to be. He said, number one, you got to deny yourself. Number two, you got to take up your cross. This is where the suffering comes in. Restoration Church, I need you to hear your pastor today. You cannot be a believer and not take up your own cross. At some point, we've got to, glory God, help me to say this right. Yes, we sing about the cross that he bore for us. Yes, we praise him for the cross that he died on. But at some point, we got to get from his cross to your cross. I need you to ask somebody on your road, say, where's your cross? He died on his cross that you might live, but there's a cross that you got to die on too. And we spend so much time talking about the cross of Christ, and we should, because his Christ is the example for us. But Jesus is asking the church, where is the cross for you to die on? At what point do you suffer? At what point do you prove your love for me? I have proven my love for you. I stepped out of the luxury of heaven for you. I came to the earth for you. Came as Mary's baby and was raised until the age of 30 years old. Started ministry for you. Went through suffering for you. Bled and died for you. Wounded for your transgressions. Bruised for your iniquities. Died on a bloody cross. Rose up from the dead. Ascended into heaven. And you want all of this for free. I need you to tell somebody, say, neighbor, this is going to cost you. Salvation is free, but a relationship with God is going to cost you. You being saved will always be free because we are saved by faith through grace. It will always be free, but a relationship with God, when you say you want to be anointed, the olive has to be crushed. At some point, I've got to suffer for what I believe. I want to know him. This is the challenge, Elder Rosa, that John had in prison in Matthew chapter 11, because John thought that it was going to be easy. You remember John, while he's sitting in a prison cell, he sent two of his disciples to Jesus and he only had one question. He said, go and ask Jesus, are you he that should come? Or are we looking for somebody else? Because I can't figure out, if you are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, why am I sitting in a prison cell? I wonder if I have about 15 people in here who say, Pastor, sometimes I question if God is even real. Because if God is real, why am I facing everything? Or y'all gonna be quiet on me over here? Let me try this side. Why am I facing all the hell I'm facing if I'm suffering right now? They tell me he supplies all of my needs when I'm broke. They tell me he's a healer, but I'm sick. They tell me that he loves me, but I feel lonely. And sometimes I have this conundrum in my head because I'm trying to figure out, how can God say he loved me when I feel so unloved? I'm just looking for an honest church in this room to say, sometimes I have questions. I love God. Tell somebody, come on, tell them, be honest. Tell them, sometimes I have questions. I do love God, but sometimes I'm trying to figure out, where is the God I say I serve? Seem like he's omnipresent everywhere but here. Y'all not gonna talk to me here. He's all powerful except when it comes to my situation. He's with me and he's with everybody else, but he's not here with me. And sometimes I have questions about the God that I can preach to everybody else. John says, are you he that should come? Because before today I knew that you were God, but now I'm in a prison cell. And there's something about where you are in God that will make you question whether God is really with you. There's something about your situation that will fuel your fear of God. There's something about what you're going through that will make you want to turn away from God and turn away from your relationship with God. Walk away from your ministry and from your anointing, because there's something about a prison cell that will quickly change your mind. And the same John. Same John who leaped in the womb with Jesus. This same John who saw Jesus at the pool and said, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. This same John is now questioning if Jesus is even the Messiah. Because I can't fathom him being God and me being this broken. Now John has to find God again. And Jesus sends a message to John. He says, John, he sends a message to the disciples. He says, go and tell John that the blinded eyes are being opened. Go and tell John that the ears are being opened. Go and tell John that the dead is being raised. In other words, he says, just because you're in a situation right now does not mean that I'm not God. It might not be happening for you, but through your suffering, it's happening for somebody else. And sometimes God will take you through some things and it has nothing to do with you. I knew I was going to have a quiet church in here today, but I need you to lean on somebody and say, everything is not about you. Sometimes God will put you on a job you don't like because there's somebody he's trying to get to. He will put you in a family that you can't stand because there's somebody he's trying to get to. Not everything God does for you is for you. He will place you in a situation for somebody else. Don't like me today, Jeremiah. He says, John, just because you're offended don't mean I'm not God. Just because you're sitting in a prison cell don't mean you're not God. And the truth of the matter is, Chris, there's no ending, perfect ending to the story, because you read on further, John would be beheaded. So he ends up giving up his entire life for somebody else to be blessed. But Jesus said, as long as the gospel is being preached, you have to preach about John the Baptist. Why? Because this is the forerunner. He is the one that would come before me. And I came to tell somebody here, without John, you do not have Jesus. So he suffered much for souls to come to Jesus. And maybe you're in a season of suffering. I feel the Holy Ghost in here today. Maybe you're in a season of suffering for somebody else to come to Jesus. Lean on somebody and say, this is not about you. You might be the one crying, but somebody's about to be saved through your tears. Somebody's about to be blessed through your experience. Someone's about to be blessed through your suffering. And I've made up in my mind, if I have to suffer for somebody to come to Jesus, yes, Lord. If I have to suffer for somebody to know God, yes, Lord. Look how quiet y'all got right there. But I need about 50 mature people to say, I'm willing to suffer for souls. Y'all got quiet. Y'all got quiet. Come on, shake it off. Shake it off. Shake it off. Shake it off. I need you to declare by faith. Say, I'm willing to suffer for souls, whatever it takes. You know why he got quiet, elder? Because we are so materialistic. Everything we want is about us. If God don't give me a new car, I'm not dancing. If God don't give me a new house, I'm not going to do nothing. If God don't bless me, I'm not even coming. You can forget me serving. You can forget me praising. You can forget me worshiping, because it's all about me. But I need 15 mature people in this house to say everything isn't about me. If a soul gets saved while tears are running down my face, it is all right with me. They that sow in tears. It said they shall reap, but it didn't say who should reap. Sometimes I cry and you reap. I need you to look at somebody and say, as long as somebody's getting what they need, as long as somebody's reaping something, it's all right with me. As long as somebody knows who God. Suffering is necessary. In football, they call it necessary roughness. It is necessary that I suffer for the cause of Christ. If I wanted to be a popular pastor, I could tell you all day that everything's going to be okay and God's going to bless you and he's going to give you everything that you need and you're going to be happy every day. But the truth be told, listen to me, it might get worse before it gets better. And as the day of his coming is drawing near, the church will suffer more persecution. We are not going to see happiness and joy until we get on the other side of Jordan. But I came to tell somebody, when you connect yourself to Christ, things will get worse before they get better. But the reason why, yes, Maya, it's a harsh reality. But the reason why I'm not discouraged, because I'm not living for this life anyway. You see, everyone can't get this because all of our eggs are in this basket. But I need about 50 people in this room who are still excited about heaven. 50 people in this room who say, this is not my only destination. 50 people in this room who say, I still want to get to heaven one day, to give somebody a high five and say, there is a better life after this. I'm not crying all these tears living this life just to enjoy this life. But I got news for somebody. By and by, I wish I had someone to talk to me in this room. I need you to high five somebody. Say, there's something better after this. There's something. We are just pilgrims and sojourners. We are passing through this life. This is why we don't like the hymns of the church anymore, because the hymns of the church consistently remind us that it's not about where we are right now, but it's about where we're trying to go. We put too much energy in time when God is trying to prepare us for eternity. There must be a time of suffering. Take your seats. Let me work through this. Can y'all give me about 5 more minutes? Let me work through this. So, Jacob is suffering. Jacob is in a season of suffering. His daughter had just been taken by Shechem. And they read the chapter before, the Shechem incident, where his daughter is taken and Shechem dies and everybody dies. And now Jacob is in this complicated place. Jacob is in this frustrated place. And God says to him, he looks at him in the first verse of chapter 35. And he said, I need you to do something for me. Media, get up if you can. Genesis 35 and 1. He says, I need you to do something for me. I need you to go up. I need you to arise. And I need you to go up to Bethel. There's a few instructions Lord told me to give you, Restoration Church, because if you're going to find God again, the first thing God told me to tell you is that it's time to get up. Mm-hmm. I need you to look at somebody and say, God said arise. Because there are some of you who are so low in your depression. There are some of you who come to church, but church is not in you. You come to church out of obligation. You come to church out of routine. But I need you to get your passion back for God. I didn't say get your passion back for church. This message is not called finding church again. This message is called finding God again. And I came to talk to somebody. You have a problem with church because you have a problem with God. You will always have a problem coming to church when your relationship with God is not right. God, I feel like preaching in here. We've already shouted, so we may not shout no more. But I came to fix somebody in here that's broken, because this is the season where God is saying it's time to arise from your slumber and go back to Bethel. Bethel is the same word as Luz. That word means the house of God. He says, the first thing, if you're going to find God again, you have to go back to Bethel. Listen to me, church. The church is not God, but the church keeps me connected to God. I don't hear nobody on this side. I said the church is not God, but the church keeps me connected to God. I get afraid of people who say, I don't need the church to have a relationship with God. Really? How's that working out for you? Because when you have no accountability to pray and no accountability to study, no accountability to fast, of course you think you're doing well when you are the measure of your own success. But you need somebody who will say, you're not where you need to be. That's why I love the church, mother, because they tell us the truth. They will look at us and say, you preach a good message, but you're shallow. You got to go study some more. Y'all remember that kind of church? You'll be up here praying. They say, you pray real good, but you pray like you don't really know him. Go back to the altar and pray again. We need some people around here who will challenge us and keep us accountable. And there cannot be no accountability without Bethel. He said, arise and go to Bethel and dwell there. And look what he said. I need you to do something specific. He said, I need you to make an altar. Everyone say, make an altar. Restoration Church, we spend too much time coming to an altar instead of building an altar. Let me say that one more time. We spend too much time coming to an altar when God wants us to build an altar. The altar is a meeting place between me and God. It is where I meet God. Let me tell you this. If you have an altar in the church and don't have an altar in your car, you will be in trouble. If you have an altar at the church and don't have an altar in your house, you will be in trouble. Where do you kneel at home? Where is your secret place? Oh, I'm preaching to me like I'm preaching to you. Where is your secret closet? Where do you meet God outside of 5840 Kirby Road? Because we will come to church and say, I can't wait to get to church. I want to lay out on the altar. You forgot that God said to make an altar. At some point, you've got to build what you've been running to. He said, make an altar. I need you to look at somebody and say, God said, build it. Look at somebody and say, God said, build it. At some point, you got to turn your house into a prayer closet. At some point, it can't just be in the house of God. It's got to be in your own house. I said to my wife yesterday, driving down the road, we have prayer meeting every week in our house, and we missed a couple of weeks. I said to her in the car, we got to go back to prayer. We got to get the children back to prayer. Make sure there's prayer meeting in your house on a regular, y'all are talking to me, on a regular basis. I need you to look at somebody and say, build an altar. As a child, Elder Rosa, I hated prayer meeting in my house. Y'all not gonna talk to me. Hey, what a waste of time. We could pray at the church. Now we have weekly prayer meetings in my house as a family. In my mama's house, we had prayer meeting every day. I'm not talking about just getting in a circle and praying. I'm talking about a full prayer service. I'm talking about guitars and tambourines, and one of us has to testify, one of us got to preach, somebody got to have a song. It was an hour every day. You be in the middle of a show, and mommy walk in and say, it's prayer meeting time. Like, I'm in the middle of a show. But let me tell you something. Let me tell you something. As a 37-year-old man, I'm grateful. I'm thankful for those days now. Why? Because they taught me how to pray. My relationship with God is not shallow, and it's not based on church and based on man. I have a prayer life for myself. And listen to me, parents, if we don't put it in our children now, we will lose them to the prison system. We'll lose them to TikTok and to social media. If we don't put more in them than just a social media experience, we don't put more in them than just a dance. I don't mind Ava dancing, but she got to know how to pray too. Y'all not talking to me here today. She can pray as well as she dances. That is my assignment as her father, that while she's dancing with her 2 feet, she going to learn the God that she's dancing for. I need you to look at a parent and say, get it right, get it right. Because you only have one opportunity to return prayer to your house. Make an altar. I'm almost done. I didn't come to go this hard, but I feel the Holy Ghost in here today. He says, I need you to go to Bethel. I need you to go to the house of God and build an altar there. Run to verse 2, run to verse 2 media. We're going to verse 7. I'm going to take my seat. He says, so Jacob told everyone in his household. Let me talk to the fathers and the husbands. It is your responsibility to take care of your household. Let me say that one more time. It is your responsibility. Yes, my wife is a prayer warrior, but it is my responsibility to pastor my house. If my house is in shambles, it is my fault. If my house is not together, it is my fault. I don't hear no brothers talking to me in here. It is your responsibility to pastor your family. Jacob told everyone in the house, he said, here's what I need you to do. Get rid of all your pagan idols and purify yourself and put on clean clothing. Restoration Church, God told me to tell you today that before we walk into 2024, God's going to remove from you everybody that you have to drag into your relationship with God. I need you to look at somebody and say, dragging is draining. Some of you are in a season where you're feeling drained because you're having to drag this one and drag that one. But God said, in this season, I'm going to put people around you who will build you up. I'm going to put people around you who will feed you. I'm going to put people around you who will bless you. If you believe that, somebody shout hallelujah. The reason why you can't take dragging in 2024 is because you will lose direction. You will lose focus. And for some of you, you have direction and focus, but you find yourself losing strength because I have to fight for me and I got to fight for everybody else. But I declare in this season that God's going to put people around you who have the more strength than you. Help me preach to somebody, please. Look at somebody and say, no more dragging. Find somebody else and say, no more dragging. Let me get these 3 points out the way, Zion, and let's have church. Number one, we've got to get rid of strange gods. Somebody shouted, write it down. Number one, God said you got to get rid of strange gods. Jacob's children kept foreign gods. But Elder Rosa, I need you you to know why he kept foreign gods. Because Rachel kept foreign gods. His mother kept foreign gods. And so Jacob was just carrying out his mother's demons. Jacob was just carrying out the generational curse that his mother had set up. The Bible said in Genesis 31 and 19 that Rachel clung close to the household of idols. And I came to tell somebody, some of the idols you're fighting right now don't have anything to do with you, but you are fighting demons that your daddy couldn't win. You're fighting demons that your mama couldn't fight. And so now you find yourself drained because you're fighting yours and you're fighting theirs. But God told me to tell you in this season, I'm going to put a supernatural strength on you. I'm going to put a multi-generational strength on you. That you will have strength for what's behind you. Have strength for what you have right now. And have strength for what's in front of you. Look at somebody and say, get rid of strange gods. And then he looked at him and he said, number two, I need you to purify yourselves. Look at somebody and say, purify yourself. Because the truth is, God cannot use a dirty vessel. Yes, Lord. Come on, Jeremiah, let's have church. God showed me this illustration. He said, I need you to show restoration, church. What I'm trying to say, this is a dirty cup. This is a clean cup. Let me tell you, restoration, church, God loves both cups equally. Yes, Lord. If you were going to run around the church, you should run around because of this fact. He loves both cups equally. Yes, Lord. Let me say that one more time. He loves both cups equally. Why should that get you excited? Because you know there were times that you represented the dirty cup. Come on, all you holy people who keep acting you got everything right. But I need 50 people in here who say, I know what it is to be the cup out of control. I know what it is to be clean on the outside, but have a dirty inside. Y'all not want to preach to me today, but I need you to high five your neighbor. I say, he loves both sides of me. Even if you don't love both sides of me, I serve a God who loves me beyond measure. I serve a God who didn't throw me away just because I was dirty. I serve a God who didn't throw me away when I was losing my mind. Grab your neighbor. Say, he loves all sides of me. But that's not what he said. God is telling me to tell you, even though I love both, I can't use both. Even though I love them, both of them have my name on it. Both of them belong to me. I purchased both with my blood. But when it gets time for ministry, I can't use what's not ready for me. I can only use clean vessels. I can only use. Now some of y'all acting like your hands are just dirty. But some of our minds, y'all not gonna talk to me in here. Because you have a clean track record, doesn't mean your mind ain't messed up. And Jesus said, if you don't have control over your mind, you don't have control over your body. You didn't do it, but you thought about it. And God told me to tell you, in this season, I can love you, but I can't use you until you turn yourself over and say, create in me, Lord, a clean heart, oh God, and renew a right spirit within me. Find your preacher neighbor. What key we in Zion? Find your preacher neighbor in the key of F and say, neighbor. Y'all not doing it. Go ahead and find somebody. Say, neighbor, God told me to tell you, he wants to use you, but you got to be holy, sanctified, purified. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies how a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable, which is your reasonable service, and be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Maya, I feel like running. I feel like running because he had grace on me when I was trying to get my world together. I don't want to talk to you, but let me see these people in the house who say, I'm so glad he waited for me. I'm so glad he blessed me. I'm so glad that he gave me what I needed. Shake somebody's hand and say, neighbor, it's time to get right. Look at somebody else. Say, let's get it right. I gotta go to my seat. Number one, he said, get rid of your strange gods. Number two, purify yourself. But here it is. I got to go, Devante. Number three, put the scripture back up for me, Erica. I want them to see it with their own eyes. He said, number one, get rid of strange gods. Number two, purify yourself. But the last line says, tell them, if they're gonna fight me again, change your garments. Can I preach like I feel? Ephesians 4 says that you gotta put off your former conduct, the old man that grows according to the lust of the flesh. Isaiah said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Let me go to verse 2. I came to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord, to console those who mourn in Zion, and to give them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, and the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. Do me a favor, y'all. Find your Holy Ghost neighbor and say, neighbor, God wants to change your garments. Look at them and say, oh, neighbor, take off the heaviness. Oh, neighbor, take off depression. Neighbor, take off unhappiness. Take off whatever's not like God and put on the garment of praise. The rest of you, happy Thanksgiving. But for those of you who ain't got too much food in your system, shake somebody's hand and say, neighbor, it's time to change your clothes. I don't see you doing it from the front to the back, from the left to the right. Look at them and say, neighbor, you look real good. You came to church looking good today, but your clothes ought to reflect your praise. Take off heaviness. You got on Gucci, but I still see depression on you. You got on H&M, but I still see unforgiveness on you. But God said, it's time to change your clothes. High five your neighbor and say, neighbor, let's go back to God. Let's go back to holiness. Let's go back to Jesus. Change. Change. Tell you. your neighbor, get changed, get changed. Get. Find somebody else, say, get changed. Jacob changed his garments. I'm not preaching no more. Jacob changed his garments. And God said to him in verse 7. Put up verse 5. And they journeyed, and the terror of God was upon the cities that were around them. Here's going to be your testimony. And they did not pursue the sons of Jacob. I need you to look at somebody. The Lord told me to give you one word. I need you to look at somebody like they got the Holy Ghost and say, God said, your family will be bypassed. I just need about 50 people in here to high five somebody and say, my family is being bypassed. Everything the devil's trying to do, God's going to make sure it passes by my family. Depression will bypass my family. Low self-esteem will bypass my family. Anxiety will bypass my family. I need you to shake somebody's hand. Say, God said bypass. I didn't come for everybody today, but I need to find somebody who's going through a generational curse right now. I came to find somebody who's going through trouble right now. I came to tell you the blood on your door is still working, and God about to bite. When I see the blood, I will. Somebody shout your last name and say, bypass my family, bypass my children, bypass my marriage, bypass my job, bypass my pastor, bypass my church. It's gonna bypass. Verse 6. So Jacob came to Luz, that is Bethel, which is in the land of Canaan, he and everyone who was with him. Everyone who survived the terror of God. Here it is, and I'm finished, I'm done. Everybody standing on your feet. And he built an altar there. After the terror of God had passed through the city, he built an altar there. And he called the name of this place something different. The first name we got was Bethel, which means the house of God. After he removed his idols, after he exchanged his garments, after the terror of God had bypassed him, he said, this is no longer just Bethel. You see, for too long, we've had a relationship with the church. Bethel is the church, it's the house of God. And we will come to church, we will dance, we will bless God, and we'll have good church. But Jacob said, there's more than just church. The church is Bethel. He said, but now I'm in a different place now. Whew. I need you to look at somebody. Don't say it if you don't mean it. You ain't got to say this one. You ain't got to say this one. But if you mean it, say it. Look at somebody and say, I'm in a different place now. Some of y'all just said it. I'm talking about those of you who truly mean it. Look at somebody else and say, I'm in a different place now. I want more than just a relationship with church. I want more than just coming to church on Sunday and on Thursday and just coming and having a good time and being around people. I'm in a different place now. I'm over my addiction to Bethel. I'm over my addiction. I'm through just posting, shouting videos all the time and just having good church. And here, we had good church today. And, oh, yes, this happened and that happened. All of that is just church. And if you're not careful, we will love church more than we love God. Jacob said, there's more than Bethel. I feel a heavy anointing in this room. I'm gonna call this place something different, Deacon Ian. He said, the place I'm in right now is El Bethel. Well, Pastor, Bethel is the house of God. What is El Bethel? El Bethel is the God of the house of God. He said, I don't just know the house. Now I know the God of the house. He said, I have found God again. How do I know? Because God appeared to me when I was in the midst of fleeing from my brother. Restoration Church, I want this to be your testimony this week. I don't just know Bethel, but I know El Bethel. I'm not just finding church again, because church will disappoint you. I preached it in Philadelphia yesterday. We cannot get so addicted to church and preach church all the time, because then when church fails you, you will leave God, because church was your God. But if we preach Jesus, even when the church fails, I'll stay with the church, because I know the church is the bride of Christ. I don't have a relationship with just Bethel. I have a relationship with I need you to put your hand on somebody's shoulder and say, it's time to know the God of the house. Find about two more people. Put your hand on them and say, it's time to know the God of the house. I don't want to just know the house of God, but I want to know the God of the house. Who's ready to know the God of the house? Lift your hands if you're ready to know the God of the house. Don't just lift it. I feel like there's an obligatory spirit in here. People just start doing it because I said do it. No, I want you to be real with it. If you really want to know the God of the house, slip your hands up if you really want to know the God of the house. For the next 2 minutes is what I need from you. I need you to build an altar. There's not going to be an altar call today. Nobody's going to come to the altar, because it's an oxymoron to preach about building an altar and then ask people to come to a built altar. I want you to build an altar where you are. Pastor, what am I doing? I'm building a meeting place between me and God. So whatever posture you got to get in for you to meet God, I want you to get in that posture right now. If it's your hands being raised, do it. If it's your mouth being open, do it. But somebody get in a posture to build an altar before God. For the next 3 minutes, we're going to build an altar. For the next 3 minutes, we're going to build an altar. For the next 3 minutes, we're going to build an altar. Now, if some of you want to come to the altar to build an altar, you can do that. I don't want you to come for someone to lay hands on you. But if you want to come to the altar to build an altar, the altar is open if you want to build an altar at the altar. But wherever you are, I want you to build it. I want you to build it. A meeting place between you and God. Come on, open your mouth all over the room. Open your mouth all over the room. Open your mouth all over the room. You can't build it with your mouth closed. Again, you'll find him when you build it. You'll find him when you build it. You'll find God when you build an altar. Build it. Build it. Build it. Build it. Build the altar. Build the altar. I won't be satisfied. I won't be satisfied until I build it. He's going to meet you at the built altar. He's going to meet you. I don't want Bethel. I want El Bethel. Oh! Come on, 10 more seconds. 10 more seconds. The Lord is speaking to somebody. The Lord is speaking to somebody. The Lord is speaking to somebody. Build it. If you have to rebuild it, rebuild it. If it broke down and you got to put it back together, say, God, here's my altar. 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 God, we ask you for forgiveness today. For times that we have put Bethel before El Bethel. We repent as a church. For times that we had more relationship with people than we did with you. We repent as a church. For times that we did not put you first. We turn our church over to you. Help us not to glorify ourselves, but help us to remember that you are the God of the house. We declare El Bethel over Restoration Church. We declare El Bethel over our family. We declare that we don't just know the house of God, but we know the God of the house. Create in us a clean heart, oh God. Renew a right spirit within us. Take not your Holy Spirit away from us. But as a church today, we want to be the clean vessel that you can use. We know you love us, but you can't use a dirty vessel. And so now, God, we ask you to perform surgery on us right now. Come on, open your mouth, church. Ask the Lord to perform surgery on you right now. God, perform surgery on my heart. Perform surgery on my mind. Perform surgery in my spirit. Take out every imperfection that's not like you. That we can walk worthy of the vocation that you've given us. We declare that we have found you again. We found you because you found us. And we thank you for the victory in Jesus' name. Everyone say amen. Now I want you to do it because I said it. I want you to do it because you feel it in your spirit. I want you to give God the loudest praise you've given him all day long. Come on. Open your mouth. Stand on your feet. Come on, jump on your feet. And I need you to scream praise to God. Not for the church, but for God. Not for the church, but for God. Somebody bless him. Oh, yeah. Come on, take the next 30 seconds and open your mouth and tell the Lord thank you. Somebody shouted, El Bethel, El Bethel. Not just the house of God, but I'm blessing the God of the house. Hello, yeah. Do me a favor. I need you to leave out of your seat and find five people that's not on your row and tell them this is El Bethel season. Come on, move quick, move quick. Find five people that's not on your row. I say, this is El Bethel season. Na, 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 na. Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's not just about the church anymore. It's about the God of the church. Yeah. Something is shifting in your house because El Bethel is God of the house now. Something is shifting in your money because El Bethel is God of your money now. Something is shifting in your body because he's El Bethel of your body. I need you to shake somebody's hand. Say, he's El Bethel. Yeah, no, 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 no. Oh, ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba- and praise El Beth. down. Ow! Restoration Church, God is sending hundreds of people to our church as long as we put El Bethel first. I need you to look at somebody, say the church is about to explode, because it's not about the church, it's about the God of the church. Shake somebody's hand and say expansion is coming. Listen. Restoration Church, I want to prophesy over you. I want to prophesy over you. Because what God's getting ready to do next will not just be for your church. I want to be clear about the prophetic word the Lord is dropping in this house. What God is doing next is not about the church. It's about your house. El Bethel will not start in the church. It's going to start at home. There's getting ready to be a shift in your house. You see, how you respond is important. When you're quiet, it means that God won't do it for you. Why? Because you have to respond when the prophetic word is released. I'm going to say it one more time. There's about to be a shift in your house. I declare before the year is out. This one's not about 2024. It's about 2023. I declare before the year is out, there's going to be a supernatural shift in your house. I'm not just talking about a spiritual shift. It's going to start spiritual, but then it's going to expand to your money. It's going to expand to your family. It's going to expand to everybody connected to you. I literally see huge debt being wiped out. I need you to hear what the Lord said. He didn't say paid off. He said wiped out. I need you to look at somebody and say, it's going to be wiped out. And all of this is happening because I'm no longer worshiping Bethel, but I'm worshiping the... Look at somebody and say, neighbor, I'm going to take the next 60 seconds and give him an El Bethel praise. I need you to find somebody on the other side and scream at them and say, neighbor, the next 60 seconds belongs to El Bethel. I need about 50 people to start dancing right now. If you believe God's doing something in your house. Oh, come on, El Bethel. Come on, church. If you know El Bethel. Somebody say, El Bethel's on his way to my house. El Bethel's on his way to my house. Everybody, something's happening. Something is shifting. Something is breaking. Something is happening. It's going to happen at my house, and then God's going to do it at the church. Healing is coming to my house. Victory is coming to my house. Joy is coming to my house. Ow! Shift. it for you. He's doing it for the generation after you. How? He's doing it for generations coming behind you. I wish you could see what I see. Before December 31st, God is getting ready to shift some things in your favor. I wish you could see what I see. You would dance him more if you could see what I see. Something is getting ready. We're getting ready to go up. We're getting ready to expand. How? We're getting ready to expand. We're getting ready to expand. God's gonna do it. 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 I said God's gonna. Somebody shout El Bethel. Prayed for, everything you fasted for, it's getting ready to show up at your door. How? It's getting ready to show up at your door. y'all, get it together. All of my need.
All of my need.
Y'all come together, get it together.
All of my need.
Say all of my needs.
All of my need. We often use that scripture to talk about money. But God gave me a revelation a long time ago. I said, the needs that I'm supplying is not just financial. But I will supply your emotional needs.
Yes, you will.
I will supply your spiritual needs. I need you to look at somebody and say, all means all. Some people don't need financial needs, but some people have an emotional need in here. And God told me to tell you, I'm getting ready to fill the gap that somebody else left off. I need you to lean on somebody and say, all of my needs means all of my needs. All means all. All means all. Say all of my needs.
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 Supply.
Passion Church. I love you. I need you to tell somebody this is an El Bethel church. Come on, point to somebody and say it's an El Bethel church. 10 more seconds. Scream at somebody. Say, all of my needs. God bless you. Keep going, Zach. Time to go home. I'm done. Happy Thanksgiving. God will supply how many? I want you to repeat it every day this week. God shall supply how many? Every need will be met.